Also the Executive Associate Director for Enforcement and Removal Operations. You've been with ICE for 24 years?
About 24 years, yes.
All right, so you know about this. This has been your entire career. So the deal is looking, and I know you haven't seen the details, so I know that, but the deal is looking to give ICE a little more flexibility when it comes to funding. In the end, there would actually be an increase in funding that would allow the number of beds to increase, maybe as high as 60,000 people in detention centers. That's obviously a jump from what you have right now. What do you think about that?
I think that provision holds promise. I think giving ICE the ability and the flexibility to manage its beds as it needs to meet the operational requirements of both our detention needs and those of individuals arrested at the border is critical to this process. The biggest concern that ICE had all along with this was the artificial cap that was trying to be placed on the number of beds that could be utilized for interior arrests. That creates a defined, definite public safety risk, and that's something that we just cannot have.
So if you don't have that, then is that a provision that is something with your expertise you could stand behind and you could say to the president, this fits our needs?
I would say for that provision with regard to the detention, that we have gotten over that hurdle. If there are no limitations on how ICE manages its beds and we are funded to get the number of beds that we actually need, for this provision, yes, I think we're good. What else is in that contained in that, I don't know, and there could be other things that are problematic.
Do you feel that ICE has been heard from lawmakers and from the White House? Have lawmakers consulted with you? Has the White House consulted with you on this?
Well, we certainly work with the individuals on the Hill and in the White House on a day-to-day basis. I'm obviously an operator. I'm a career law enforcement official. I'm not involved in the political spectrum, but they certainly have come to us for our opinions with regard to what the impact of any certain legislation may be.
So I know that one of your concerns when it comes to limiting that cap on beds, and of course, I know that you can only have as many beds as you can afford, right? That's why the budget is so important. But I know one of your concerns that you've talked about has been if you actually had an overflow and you would have to release people. You talk about releasing violent criminals. Is there room to release offenders who are nonviolent criminals? Because there are a lot of them in detention.
Well, there are a lot of people that ICE releases annually. So we've released about 168,000 people so far this year for myriad reasons. It could be because the individual poses has a humanitarian issue and there's a medical condition that does not make them suitable for detention. It could be because the individual has equities here in this country and is able to be released. There's a lot of times an immigration judge will release that individual on bond. So not all the discretion lies with ICE. But 72% of the people that we have in custody, Congress has already declared those individuals to be subject to mandatory detention, meaning Congress has passed laws which state that these individuals pose both either a flight or a safety risk, and as such, need to be detained during the pendency of their immigration proceedings.
When you look at the increase in asylum seekers, a 1,700% increase that we've seen, it's huge. How does that fit in with what you think Congress needs to do in order to address you see as a problem?
We've been maintaining for years that these are problems that are largely solvable by Congress. The Border Patrol is apprehending over 30,000 family units a month. We were able to remove less than 3,000 family members.
Apprehending, or you mean, are these ones through legal ports? Or because I'm just being
Most of them are coming between the ports of entry.
Okay, so apprehending to me says they're trying to sneak over the border. But
most
these
of
are
them
people
now are not even trying to sneak over the border. They're just the coyotes are directing them to the border. They come across and they turn themselves into the Border Patrol because they know that we do not have the capacity or the authority to hold these individuals. We've released 48,000 family units since mid-December. There are over 30,000 a month coming in, turning themselves into the Border Patrol, requesting asylum. And because the threshold is so low, most of them reach that initial bar. And as such,
but officials and humanitarian officials say that the bar is actually not low, and that the reason there are more people coming in is because of the violence. I mean, you're looking at El Salvador, Honduras, Venezuela. We're talking about some of the most dangerous nations in the world.
Only about 10% of the people that actually come from those countries and actually claim asylum or follow through with their asylum claims actually receive asylum. So the initial credible fear threshold for that initial claim is extremely low bar. And Congress is aware of this. We've talked about
You're saying only 10%
actually ultimately succeed in an asylum claim in front of an immigration judge.
Well, then how does that make the case where you say that the bar is too low? You're saying for initially.
It's complicated, but there are two things. So when the individual is arrested or
and
turns themselves in.
And then they're waiting. They're waiting to see whether their claim will actually be accepted, so, and they'll be granted that status.
Most of them will claim credible fear when they're arrested. They say a couple key phrases. That reaches a credible fear threshold. They are then released. Half of those individuals that are released that receive positive credible fear never actually follow through and file an asylum claim. Those that do, only a small percentage of those actually get asylum in front of an immigration judge. Again, of this entire universe, 10% of them actually receive asylum. So you're getting 30,000 fraudulent or ineligible asylum claimants at the port of at the border every month.
It also depends on the region you're looking at. If you're looking at someplace like New York, asylum claims are granted at a much higher rate than, say, Georgia.
Well, again, immigration judges have discretion to look at the evidence in front of them. That's an arm of DOJ and how they look at that evidence and rule on it. That's a separate thing. But I think if you look across the board with the vast number of asylum claimants.
I guess my point is, don't they have a reason, many of the people who are seeking, because you've seen this trend towards individuals, male individuals, and now families. You're seeing a different customer, if you will, for refuge in the United States. Doesn't that tell you that they're actually fleeing something?
No,
it tells
us
they say some key phrases, which means you're really casting doubt on whether their claim is real.
Well, the statistics cast doubt on that because 10% are only actually receiving asylum. They are coming because they know that they can game the system.
The UN says 80% of the asylum seekers actually would meet the standard for what asylum should be. You said it, judges have discretion. It's also arbitrary.
They do. Judges have discretion. What I can tell you is the statistics show 10% actually receive it. So what you have is a situation where individuals are coming here because they know, especially family units, that there's no way for ICE to detain them. We don't have the authorization or the funding with which to do so, and that they will be released into the interior of the country. And most of them generally never even show up for their hearing. We ran a project
That's not true.
It is.
It's not true.
Let me explain to you. We ran a project with DOJ, try to accelerate this docket for family units so that we could try to reduce the number that are coming to the border. Within the past 8 months, 2,600 cases were completed by DOJ on these family units. 2,500 of them ended up in removal orders that were issued in absentia, meaning 97% of the people did not show up for the hearing.
The Obama era pilot, the program, which was the family case management, there was a 100% attendance in court that they had. And actually, the number, I'm not saying it's, there's still a lot of people who are not showing up for court, right?
When you look at the numbers. We've got 560,000 fugitives.
Tens of thousands of people, but 60 to 75% of migrants who were released pending court hearings, with the statistics from the last five available years, actually showed up for the court hearings, and the numbers are higher for asylum seekers. That's just migrants in general.
Well, the family case management system was a very small, select individuals.
That's not what I'm talking about. This is overall. So I mentioned that case management system. Those numbers have to do with the total number of migrants who are released pending court appearances, and also the higher, what is a higher number for asylum seekers.
Right. So what you have to look at is, many of these cases drag on for years. So individuals will show up for the first hearing, the second hearing, the third hearing, and then attendance and compliance with those requirements gradually taper off, especially as they get to the point where they realize that they're going to be ordered removed and their claim is not going to be found valid. Those individuals do not show up at that point. Again, we have 560,000 fugitives. That means individuals who have been through the complete immigration process, have been ordered removed, and have failed to comply with that order. And that number grows every month.
I would love to talk to you about the statistics offline.
Absolutely.
Because I'm seeing a very different picture. You've been with ICE for 24 years?
About 24 years, yes.
All right, so you know about this. This has been your entire career. Matt Albence, thank you so much.
Thanks
really appreciate you coming to be in studio with us from ICE.
Anytime.
Thank you.
Thank you.